desperately need the younger generation to wake up to what especially my generation is doing to Europe. And it is very encouraging to see movements like yours starting to blossom. The floor is yours.
Okay, so I'm not actually holding a speech. I'm more or less trying to explain to you who are the identitarians, what do we do, and why does every European country, from my point of view, need an identitarian movement. So first of all, I'm going to introduce myself again. So my name is Robert Timm. I'm 26 years old. I was born in 1991 in the former east of Berlin. So actually my family has a more left-leaning socialistic background. I am political since I am 15 years old, but since I'm 18, when I turned 18, I started to reflect more on what I was told and taught in school. And that process accelerated when I went to a school in Berlin-Kreuzberg with an enormous amount of migrants, so around about 60%, and a lot of them with a Muslim background. So, I can already tell you there was like one key moment during my school career where a Holocaust survivor came to our school and told us how he survived the Holocaust. And he was actually not only verbally but also physically attacked by Palestinian students. And the school did not really react to that. Actually, what one of the teachers said was that we should not punish them too hard, because if we punish them, they will radicalize even more. And it is our obligation to prevent that. So all they did was telling them that it's not okay what they did, basically. So all of that and a few other things, like for example the attack on the Bataclan, and also here in Denmark on the I forgot his name. How's the guy called that made the caricatures? Yeah, so all of that in the end led to me contacting my local chapter just in April last year. So by that I'm not really a veteran, but pretty much since then the identitarian movement is what I do. Yeah, so university, I'm also a student at the university of architecture. But my work at the university is suffering a bit from the activism. But I hope it will be worth it in the end. So, who are the identitarians? The identitarians are an organization that was pretty much founded in France. Yeah, there it is called Génération Identitaire, and it developed from an organization called Bloc Identitaire. And it's, obviously it is a youth organization, a patriotic youth organization. And we are having branches in Austria, Germany, Czech Republic, Poland, France, Italy, Slovenia, and hopefully maybe in Denmark too. You have maybe seen our sign. It's the Greek letter lambda, which we took from the movie 300, actually, because it's on the shields of the Spartans who fought the battle at the Thermopylae against the Persian invaders. So, what makes us different from other political movements? So, we follow the concept of ethno-pluralism, which means we reject racism, but we say, okay, ethnicities are worthy something, and the diversity that we actually have on the planet is something worth to keep up, right? So for that reason, we are against mass immigration, and we reject also all sorts of anti-Semitism, racism, homophobia, and chauvinistic nationalism, which, when you call yourself a right or right-wing movement in Germany, this is always associated with these words, right? So this is why we are rejecting that so highly and condemning all sorts of actual racism. One term that is really important for us, the identitarians, is the grand replacement, which comes from the author Renaud Camus. So he's one of the writers that pretty much inspired the identitarians. And by grand replacement, like great replacement, we mean that the native population of Europe is slowly being exchanged with migrants. That this has nothing to do with a conspiracy. There are many different factors, but actually, if you look at the demographics, it's something that sooner or later, if this process is not stopped, is going to take place in Europe. Yeah? If you look at the birth rates of the native Europeans and the birth rates of the migrants and the growing influx of new migrants from Africa and Arabic countries, sooner or later, the Europeans will be a minority within, well, their own homeland. Yeah? And that's something we avoid because we say, okay, this is also related to cultural things. Yeah, if the population of Europe is not made of Europeans anymore, there won't be any European culture anymore. So also for that reason, we have to stop that. Actually, we are really one of the few European movements. You know, for example, there's this thing called now, I don't know, some governments are trying to enforce that. They say, okay, Europe is at risk. Yeah, Europe is at risk. And I think, no, it's not, because in this fight against Islamization, actually what the countries really do is come together, work together, find out that we have a lot in common. And the identitarians are actually working together. One example is every summer, French identitarians are holding a université, like a summer camp for round about a week, where, well, it's not a summer camp by that. We don't do that for the fun. Yeah, we really go there. We have lectures, we do sports, and we get to know each other's culture. It's a pretty tough program throughout the week, and both physically and mentally. And what we also do is we hold demonstrations, like last weekend in Berlin, around about 1,000 people gathered from Poland, Czech Republic, France, Germany and Italy to hold a demonstration in what I would call the heart of multiculturalism in Germany, in Berlin Wedding. And that produced some pretty strange pictures, as you can imagine. Yeah. Identitarians going through a street while there are a lot of people with hijabs looking out of their window, right? So, and this is also how we understand ourselves. Yeah, we are talking about the term phalanx. I hope this works in English as well. When the Greek fought the Persians, for example, they had this phalanx thing. So, and what is most important for the phalanx is the first line, right? And we understand ourselves as the first line in the fight against Islamization, in civilian terms, right? I mean, the real first line are people at the authorities, yeah. But in terms of civilians, we consider ourselves the first line, and this means we also have to go where, the troubles is taking place, pretty much. Yeah, and also we are pretty pluralistic within ourselves. Yeah? You have to imagine we have people that consider themselves Catholic, Lutheranian, atheists, and vegans and non-vegans. So we have a lot of pluralism without our own movement. What is also important to mention is we are strictly non-violent. All of our actions do not cause harm either to people or things. And why that is so important, I will explain later. So, I'm getting a bit sorry. Yeah. So, what do we want? We want to preserve our ethnocultural identity. That means, for example, we have to stop the mass immigration, and we also have to work on something we call remigration. So making sure that people that don't want to assimilate into our culture go back where they belong. Yeah? And also, we have to, I mean, you in Denmark, I've seen it. When I came here, my passport was actually checked. That's something I really enjoyed. We have to secure our borders, especially in Europe. And this is why we say we have to build Fortress Europe. Lefties are always crying that Fortress Europe is leading to the fact that people are drowning in the Mediterranean. We don't have a Fortress Europe right now, and people are drowning in the Mediterranean. And to be honest, it's not our fault, and I will get on that issue later on. Yeah, but this also includes that we want, in the long run, to make sure that these people that want to migrate to Europe get supported in the places they come from. Yeah? Migration does not only kill Europe, it also kills Africa, right? Because if we take away all the smart people from Africa, who's left to actually build something up in these countries? So we also want to ensure that these countries are being supported in the long run. What we also do is preservation of Yon, which has nothing really to do with migration in the first point. Preservation of Yon means, well, you can tell as a German, it is pretty difficult to talk about things like patriotism, right? Because this triggers something within the people so that they say, yeah, patriotism always leads to nationalism, and then also automatically leads to fascism. And this is why people reject all sort of patriotism. And yeah, we are trying to work on that. And we want to enable people to freely and openly admit that they are patriotic towards the country, and that they are not being labeled for that. And we also try to enforce that on a cultural level. So, like you have sung a song before, is something that we also try to develop within our movement. Yeah, it also goes to a folk dance. Yeah? All of these are things that we try to inspire within the younger generation to take part again, because, well, there are not a lot of people at my age doing that, obviously, but that has to change, yeah? And we also need a strong identity in order to make ourselves attractive for migrants that actually want to assimilate our culture. And I think patriotism is actually a way to enable people to be able to assimilate in our culture. Because in Germany, I can very well understand that a migrant does not want to consider himself German, because then automatically makes him weak. Yeah, it is much more favorable for them to say, I'm a proud Turkish guy, I'm a proud Palestinian, I'm a proud Lebanese or whatever. Yeah, but if you say you're a proud German, that has something of a bad taste in Germany at the moment. So all of that at the end comes to the fact that we are trying to stop the spirit of the generation of 68. And yeah, we want to ensure an open and honest discussion about these issues, about identity and migration. And yeah, in Germany, this is actually not taking part at the moment. Yeah. So how do we do that? I would actually consider the identitarians not even really right-winged or something. For me personally, it's just the movement of the common sense, actually. And also the movement of the silent majority, because I made the experience before I started my activism within the identitarians. I, of course, already had these views. Yeah? And when I talked to my friends, they pretty much agreed on a lot of what I was saying. But since they know that I'm with the identitarians, suddenly they start rejecting my positions. So, well, why is that working that way? Because the media portrays us as fascists, neo-Nazis, whatever. You can imagine it. So the media is actually building up, or trying to build up, an emotional barrier, because a lot of people within Europe, and especially also a lot of young people, are fed up with what is happening. But the media, by portraying us in a certain way, is building an emotional barrier so that people do not get in touch with us, yeah, and are fearful. And I mean, they have every reason to be fearful, but not because we are the bad guys, but if they are associated with us, they're being threatened with losing their jobs and getting in trouble with their families and all of that. Yeah. There are many stories I can tell you afterwards. But what we do is we produce pictures of young, attractive, smart people who are just pretty much the girl or the guy from around the corner. And this leads to, cognitive dissonance, right? When you know something is wrong, but you don't really want to believe it, right? And this is what we are causing within the people. They say like, okay, these are just average guys, but they are being portrayed as fascists and neo-Nazis everywhere. Something must be wrong by that. Yeah? And there's also something from media marketing that is called the click-through rate. Yeah? This is why we talk with all media outlets, no matter how, when I go to an interview, I already know what I can expect from them, as a result. But we talk to all of them because every of these articles is also read by somebody who does not believe the mainstream media anyways anymore. And by that, he will get in touch with us, get to know us, and then sooner or later end up joining us. And we are also trying to point out the double standards within the leftist logic, right? Like, for example, as I mentioned the story with the Holocaust survivor, they have double standards, right? If somebody else would have done that, he would have definitely been kicked out of school. So these people actually within themselves are treating migrants differently than other people. And that is what I would really consider racism at the end of the day. So how do we work? You probably heard the term, the world is a stage, right? And I would even go so far that every political event is an even bigger and more important stage. And well, the leftists are now slowly struggling, so they put up a lot of events all around the country, and they have to explain themselves, and they have to keep lying and lying so that the people still keep believing that stuff. And what we do is we have to reconquer these stages and make them into our own stages. This, of course, obviously goes hand in hand with some sort of conflict, and we are usually not invited to the events that we show up, but we show up anyway. And that's also what I'm telling them, is especially if you do not invite us, that is almost a guarantee that we will show up. So better invite us beforehand, then you can prepare yourself. We are trying to reconquer these political events, stages, but also certain places. I mentioned this action because this is probably most of the people, there's the highest chance that you have heard of it. So last year in August, we went on the top of the Brandenburg Gate. And what we did, we put a banner up there saying, secure borders, secure future. Simple as that. Four words, pretty easy, but results were they even surprised me. So I was there on that roof, and I was taken into police custody afterwards. And when I came out of the police station six hours later, and I opened my phone again, there were all the news outlets were going crazy about it. A couple of days later, I even found out that the New York Times mentioned it and all of that. But really, what actually happened was we were being charged for the breach of public peace. The breach of public peace in Germany means that you act violently against persons or things, right? Obviously, we didn't do that, but we are still being charged for that, and in the worst case, I could end up in prison for 3 years just for climbing on top of the Brandenburg Gate, putting up that banner. Obviously something is wrong within Germany. So I'm also going to explain a couple of other actions in order to maybe inspire you to plan something similar. As for example, there was a play taking place in an Austrian university. The play was called Schutzbefohlene, which means like you are obligated to protect a certain group of people that you're obligated to protect. And that play was actually written by Elfriede Jelinek, who also has the Nobel Prize for literature, I think. And part in that play, we're also taking refugees as actors. So what we did, we went on, well, not me personally, but other activists, they went on the stage with a banner saying, okay, you are actually using these people as your tokens for your political agenda. You don't really care about the people, the characters behind it. You are just putting up a big show, trying to make yourself look great. But at the end of the day, this is all about the prestige of the women who wrote this play. And we also did something that, obviously the internet is really important for us, right? So what they are trying to do now is put up some censorship for the internet. And we have a foundation, which is it's just an NGO, called Amadeo Antonio Foundation. And it's actually run by a woman who used to be a spy in the former East German Republic. So she was spying on other citizens, and people that she spied on actually even committed suicide afterwards. That does not stop our government at the moment from working together with these people and working out concepts on how to put up a censorship within the internet. So what did we do? We dressed up as officers of the former Secret Service of East Germany and went to her office with a medal and tried to give her that medal in order for great service in spying. That obviously the people did not, they were so common or so used to these uniforms, obviously, that they did not even realize that this was a joke in the first place. On how we work. All of these actions that we do, if it is distributing flyers, putting up a banner somewhere, we are all documenting this by videos and by photos. Why do we do that? Not why we are so keen to look at ourselves later in the pictures, but to spread the word even more. We are distributing our actions throughout the internet because obviously, even if you go up on the Brandenburg Gate and put up a banner, well, how many people will see that? Maybe 500, 600. So if you put it up on the internet, well, millions of people have seen at least that action, right? So the internet is really important because the effort that you put into the actions, the result will double, if not even, multiply 10 times. And we can also control which pictures we are producing, right? If we are just doing actions somewhere in the city center and we wait for the TV crews to arrive and film us maybe, you know how the result will look. They will say, okay, well, this is maybe a funny action, but actually it's neo-Nazis doing that stuff. So on the internet, we have the full control on what pictures we produce, and it's a lot harder for the media to take them out of context and put them into their own negative context. And also, of course, this motivates other people and hopefully inspires a lot more people to do so. So what we actually see is that people that don't affiliate with the identitarians sometimes even copy our actions, which I can only welcome, right? And to be honest, it also helps with the fundraising. What we are also trying to do is of course build up a network and support other places where there are probably not so many activists, so we need fundraising, and in order to tell the people what we are using that money for, it is also important to show them the results. So there's also something considering the press. So we cannot force them to tell the truth about us, but we can obviously force them to lie more and more absurd, right? Yeah. Yeah, like I mentioned, also sports and education are also quite important for us. And yeah, but what we see is we're being actually criminalized for what we do. And I have to admit, sometimes we of course cross the line between legal and illegal actions. But what we say about that is sometimes you have to break the smaller order in order to keep up the big order, right? So being convicted for breach of assembly laws or something, illegally assembling people is something we do, obviously, but only to preserve the whole system. Yeah, at the end of the day, we are just normal people who want to pay their taxes, who want to get a credit by the bank and build their houses and have a pretty regular normal life at the end of the day, right? But for the fact that we are being criminalized, while people that burn, for example, down our cars, break into our apartments, all of that, well, of course, obviously, they are also being criminalized to some extent, but I never see a result. Yeah? I know so many people by now that have somehow suffered from some left-wing extremists, but none of them was caught. One example, for example, was last year when we held a big demonstration in Vienna. One of our activists was actually hit by a stone that a left-wing activist threw at him. This guy is still out somewhere. He was never caught, but the media, how they reported, revealed pretty much everything that is wrong within Germany, but also in Austria. We were holding a spontaneous rally after the demonstration when we all found out that he is in a hospital, put into a coma and all that. We held a spontaneous rally in front of a church and did like a silent minute for him. And all the media did was reporting about this action that we assembled illegally in front of the church, but not about the fact that one of our activists was actually hit by a rock and barely made it. So and now I'm going to explain future projects of us. So for example, activists are now working on an app. You probably heard about something like Tinder. Some of you are laughing. It's not a dating app what we are producing. It's called Patriot Peer, and it's supposed to bring together patriots, because what we see in public is, there are a lot of people that when you talk to them admit that they feel somehow patriotic and are a bit more conservative or critical towards migration, but it's pretty hard sometimes for some people if they get into this whole thing, to find people who are alike. And this app is actually supposed to make it easier, because you can get in touch with patriots from around the corner. So this is what we are working on at the moment. And then my personal favorite is the mission Defend Europe. So a couple of weeks ago, some of our activists went to Italy, to a little harbor city, and rented a boat. And what they actually tried is to block off one of the so-called rescue ships that collect the people out of the Mediterranean Sea. They call themselves aid organizations. I would call them human traffickers, because it is now, I think the New York Post just posted an article about that. It is now proven that these guys work together with the actual human traffickers from Northern Africa. And these people, they just drive out of the national waters of, Libya, right? And then are being collected by these aid organizations and brought to Europe. So, I mean, it would be logical to rescue these people. It's totally fine, But what should really happen is that these people are instantly brought back to Africa, because if you bring them directly to Europe, you are working together with the human traffickers. And these guys, they have a huge funding. They get millions and millions of fundraising. And we have raised over 60,000 euros now in just a month in order to actually block these ships from getting into European harbors. So, well, we can obviously not block off all of these ships, yeah? But what we try to prove that this is actually possible to stop them, and also to, well, get the media attention onto that topic, because the majority of people still thinks that these people are being just rescued there in the middle of the Mediterranean, which is not true. They are being rescued right in front of the coast of Libya, and even the Coast Guard of Libya is not so amused about this process anymore. But yeah, we are struggling now because our bank account and our PayPal account has been cancelled without any further explanation. Well, obviously, the people that don't agree with us put up enough pressure on these on PayPal and on the banks so that they cancelled our accounts. But somebody offered us a ship now, and we are on the best way to get back all the donations that we raised before, and we are trying to get on the Mediterranean by July. So hopefully the mission Defend Europe will start and continue. So I'm finishing now by telling you why every other country needs an identitarian movement. I mean, obviously, even though I've seen here in Copenhagen, you are not, you haven't been hit so hard with the refugee crisis as we are in Germany, but it's just a matter of time, right?
Yeah, thank you.
There's thousands, hundreds of thousands of people still every day trying to come into Europe, and we as the Europeans together have to show them that the boat is full. Yeah, we cannot help everyone by letting them into Europe. And we have to sort out these problems together. And I can also see we are all facing the same problems when it comes to our youth. Yeah? The young people are distracted with video games, with, well, what they consider a career. And all of that is distracting them from the real problems, because you can have the best paid job in the future. Well, if your children have to run around with a hijab, is it really worth it? I mean, at the end of the day. And I think we all, in the German case it's a bit specific, but I think Denmark never took part in colonialism. When was the last time you invaded the country? That's like hundreds of years ago, right? So there's no reason to be ashamed of being Danish. There's no reason to be ashamed of being Swedish, Norwegian, whatever. Yeah, and it's our right to be patriotic. And that's the reason why every European country, in my opinion, needs an identitarian movement. Thank you.